Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night, and welcome to Prog Chattery 777, where today we are going to be talking about Rock Flute, the most recent album by Jethro Tull, most recent as of March of 2024. This album came out in April of 23, which is just 13, 14 months after the Zealot Gene, so back-to-back albums very late in his career, which is kind of unusual. You get these really, really long gaps that happen. Obviously, after Rupee's Dance, the Ian Anderson solo album, there's a 9-year gap before you get to Tab 2. Homo Erraticus comes pretty quickly after, about 2 years, and there's an 8-year gap to the Zealot Gene, and then just a year before we get to Rock Flute here. So, this is a kind of an interesting album. I don't want to sound too harsh on it particularly, but I think of the recent, you know, Ian Anderson slash Jethro Tull albums, you know, kind of from Tab 2, Homo Erraticus, Zealot Gene, and this one, this is probably my least favorite. You know, I've listened to it a fair bit. You know, I've given it an honest shake. I've tried my hardest. There's a lot to like on this album, but I think there's a couple of fundamental flaws that keep it grounded compared to the other stuff. For one thing, I feel it lacks some of the diversity of some of the earlier albums. If we compare it directly to the Zealot Gene, one of the things I really like about Zealot Gene is the fact that he's got these nice little acoustic numbers that are kind of peppered in to kind of give the album a bit more of a dynamic and a bit of a contrast, whereas this one is a little bit more homogenous. There obviously are peaks and valleys, but for the most part, he is going for a much kind of heavier rock-oriented sound. You know, there is acoustic guitar, but it's kind of, you know, it's peppered throughout the songs individually rather than the album as a whole. So you don't really get those nice little acoustic numbers, which, you know, I don't mind that in principle, but I think what makes it flawed in the context of Jethro Tull in 2024 is that it really doesn't do his voice any favors, unfortunately. Obviously, you know, his voice has been through a lot over the course of his career, and he does not have the tone or range that he did before, obviously. You know, I've done a video about that. You know, I think everyone kind of talks about the state of Ian's voice these days. But I find when he's doing that heavy rock thing, the voice just doesn't quite suit that. It's, you know, he's trying to make these heavy songs, and, you know, all the ingredients are there, and then, yeah, I think there's a few cases on this album where once that vocal comes in, the song is trying so hard to take off, but the voice, you know, it can't articulate the melodies that he's writing the way that he used to back in the day. And I mean, I don't want to sound super brutal, like I don't want to like a brutal situation, but it's almost like a flightless bird. It's so majestic and it's trying its hardest, but it just can't quite get up there. The vocal doesn't quite match the energy that the songs are portraying. Again, I don't want to sound too harsh on it. There is a lot to like on this album, and he's doing his best, obviously, but myself, I prefer to see him, you know, in his later years doing stuff more akin to, like, Secret Language of Birds or Rupee's Dance. I think his voice is much more suited for that acoustic setting. But, hey, what do I know? I mean, this is the kind of stuff that he's choosing to do, and all the power to him. So conceptually, again, it's another concept album. And, you know, in his later years, he does seem to have a real appreciation for doing these concept albums. This one, of course, it's a little more explicit than the concept on Zealot Gene. Zealot Gene is, you know, the concept is more how he wrote the songs and taking these biblical passages and applying them to, you know, the modern world. Whereas this one is a little bit more explicitly just about Viking mythology and Norse mythology and what have you, which is pretty cool. That said, though, I think he captured the spirit of that all too well on Cold Wind of Valhalla way back in Minstrel in the Gallery. And I think that Cold Wind of Valhalla is better than any song on here, just being totally honest. But, you know, it's a cool concept. You know, I can get behind it. You know, musically, I think it is a little bit, it's a little flat compared to, you know, Zealot Gene and the other stuff. But, you know, for what it's worth, it's great that he's still making making music, and it's great that this album exists. Record covers, you know, a little generic, I guess. You know, doing the whole one-legged flute player thing with little devil horns, and almost looks like he's got the old cod piece on there, which is very strange and awkward. But it's a part of Jethro Tull history, isn't it? Yeah, let's talk about the tracks then. So opens with a track called Voluspo. I really like the flute technique that he does at the very beginning there, that kind of that menacing sort of whisper. There's some deep, guttural breathing happening in the background, and we get a spoken word and a narrative, spoken in a Norse language. Forgive me, I'm ignorant on specifically what this lady is saying, female spoken word vocal, but very menacing, very mysterious. Kind of a cool intro, and then we get that main theme, da 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 dun dun da da da. And then it winds its way into kind of the basic musical setting of the album, which is very guitar driven, electric guitar driven rock music. And we hear the voice right away, and he's doing it. I think there is actually a technique. There's a specific name for this, where it's speak singing, where he is essentially just using his speaking voice in a very, I guess, sort of animated way. So he's implying a melody, but he's not necessarily, hitting the melody. But yeah, it's a very good intro. Again, a nice way to kind of build into the album, and it's good. It's not too bad. It gets us prepared for what's coming. Track two, I don't know how to pronounce this. Gnungagap, Gnungagap, Gnungagap. I'm not sure. I'm butchering what it's supposed to be. But this is a nice song. Again, keeps the pace up, very fairly high energy. The very beginning of the song really reminded me, for some reason, of "Enter the Uninvited" from Homo Erraticus. This is a much heavier piece than "Enter the Uninvited," but do 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 do. That's very similar to that one from Homo Erraticus, which I thought was kind of interesting. Once we get into the song, it does become its own, obviously. There's some kind of cool synth lines. There's a little bit of cool synth that's peppered throughout this album. Not as much on the certain pieces on Zealot Gene, but there's some cool synth parts. And yeah, it kind of works its way into, fairly, I don't want to say generic in a bad way, but a fairly generic, Jethro Tull rock number. There is a really, really cool part with the flute, that. It's really cool. I mean, he's playing at a very soft timbre. You can actually hear the oh God, I'm just, the keys on his flute clicking as he plays that part. So my vocabulary is terrible today. But I think that's really cool when he's playing at that really light tone, that light timbre, and hearing the keys going, clicking away there is quite neat. And that's a really cool part as well. It's a nice, it kind of a classic bit of Jethro Tull, having some involved musical bits. So yeah, Gnungagap, whatever it's called, very, very cool. We move to track three, All Father. This is one of my favorites on the album. I feel like I haven't really talked about how much Ian Anderson really appreciates writing in funny time signatures, particularly five. All Father is in five. And this is a great piece. It's really, really short. It's under 3 minutes. And it's got a really nice contrast. Very contrast. It's got a nice chipper kind of main theme to it. But the middle section towards the end, it does develop a bit of a menace. I keep messing up these little bits here. But the middle section does have a decent menace to it, and it is kind of involved and a little progressive and whatnot. And again, all the while playing around in 5/8, yeah. And it's really good. Like I said, one of my favorites on the album. It's a short piece, but it's involved. There's a lot of bits to it. It's in five, and yeah, I think it's pretty good. The voice sounds pretty good on All Father as well. Moving on to track four, we get the Feathered Consort. We get some of those nice acoustic flourishes once again, but it's not a fully acoustic song. Again, the acoustic guitar appears more as a coloring aspect rather than like the main architectural musical bit of the song, which perhaps it's a bit of a missed opportunity there, because I think this Feathered Consort would work as a largely acoustic piece, but the band elements do come in. There's some synthesized strings that are there as well. I think it's a really good song. I think some people have mentioned it could be elements of Songs from the Wood there. Unfortunately, I'm not convinced, just because Songs from the Wood, you need 1977 Ian's voice to really get that kind of stuff going. But good song by all means. Track five, Hammer on Hammer. So this is a good one. This is quite menacing. He's really taking advantage of the lower register in his voice here, which I think it is advantageous, but it is very much that speak singing thing, and particularly the first line that was there a time when I was Jupiter. The melody is very much implied rather than properly sung now. Like I say, he's doing his best for all things considered it in 2023 when this came out. But it is a little bit distracting. I think the vocals are a little bit distracting, even though he is, taking advantage of the lower register of his voice. You can't help but miss it a little bit. Miss the classic days. But it's a good song. Again, it's got a good menace. It's brooding. It's dark. I'm not sure where it falls in the story, but I do enjoy it when it comes on. Moving on to track six, we got Wolf Unchained. I find this is very this to me is the centerpiece of the album. Much more elaborate than most than a lot of the other songs, with a few exceptions. It's got a really kind of cool middle section, kind of classic bit of Tull there with different parts and different sections. Very much an upbeat rocking kind of a thing. I think the voice works on here. There's one part I really like when it goes from the middle section, it kind of cuts straight back into the verse. Do 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 do, bon dun 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 dun. You know what I mean. You've heard the album. You know the part I'm talking about. I think going from the complicated middle section straight into the verse is really good, and it drives that backbeat so nicely. So I think Wolf Unchained is pretty successful. Probably again one of the better pieces on the album. Certainly the most involved, and it's right in the middle of the album, which is really good. So yeah, good song. Moving on to track seven, we get The Perfect One. This is a perfect case, an example of what I mean with this album is I can really. It's very easy for me to pick out songs. Just I can recall songs from Tab 2, Homo Erraticus, and Zealot Gene. I'm fairly familiar with this one because I've listened to it a couple of times before making this video, of course. But after a few days, the songs just fall out of my head. I find it very difficult to recall. So again, a week from now, if I don't listen to it again, I'll look at the titles and be like, "How does that go? How does that go?" The Perfect One is a song where, I could listen to it like two or three times a day, and I can't recall it. I think it's pleasant enough. It's kind of weird that I can't recall it because this song actually does get reprised later in the album. I couldn't tell you why. It's perfectly fine when it's on. I enjoy it. It's pleasant. The verse is kind of your, classic bit of rock. And I think there's from what I can recall, I can't do how the melody goes right now, but it's a nice contrast between the hard rocking verses and the kind of lighter instrumental bit. And again, I'm trying to think of it right now, and it's not coming into my head for whatever reason, but. So probably that would imply it's one of the weaker tracks on the album, even though it gets reprised later, interestingly. So The Perfect One, that's what I said about that. We go over to where are we? Track eight, Trickster and the Mistletoe. I think this song, I like this song, don't get me wrong, but this certainly highlights the fundamental flaw of the album. Where I mentioned before, again, I don't want to sound mean, but the analogy of a flightless bird. There's a really high energy, exciting song in here, but the vocal kind of kills it. All that energy is built up. The band does a really good job of building the energy and creating a context for the song to take off, and the vocal just doesn't quite do it. He's pushing his voice. But the timbre's just not there. He's getting those notes for the melody, but you can tell he's straining to get it, and it's very distracting. However, a plus note, on the plus side regarding his voice, I think he actually does a very effective contrast. So you've kind of got the first part of the verse where he's singing higher. When the verse carries on, I guess you could call it the chorus, but it goes into the heavier part and da 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 dum bum bum da 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 da, and he uses the lower register of his voice. That's a very dramatic technique, and it actually works quite well, going from the higher bit where he is straining a bit to the lower bit where he's certainly a little bit more comfortable. And I think as a compositional technique, that does work really well. But yeah, I mean, on the whole, it does. It's a good song. I enjoy it, but it does highlight that flaw. where the music just doesn't quite suit where his voice is at right now. This to me, right, this reminds me a little bit more of like a Songs from the Wood era stuff, more than the Feathered Consort actually. Because it does have that always like that Christmassy dun 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 da da da. It's that classic folky Tal thing, right? But just with, you know, the current Tal voice or current Ian Anderson voice. I'm really dwelling on the vocals here, I guess. But that, like I said, that's the one thing that I think holds the album back. Anyway, moving on, let's go to track 9, Cornucopia. This is another highlight for me. I think this is really good in context of the album. It's a nice little bit of breathing room. Like I said, for the most part, it's pretty high energy, pretty rock oriented. This is very gentle, very calm, very piano led, but beautiful flute melody. I really love the that calm flute melody that the kind of it's the basis of the whole song, largely instrumental. I think, you know, kind of funny again, the musical context here I think is much more suited for his voice, but it's a long instrumental passage where we're presented with that lovely flute melody. Da 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 dum da da dum dum da 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 dum da da. Really nice. It's great. And then the vocal comes in. He kind of follows the flute melody again. I think his voice sounds fine on Cornucopia because the music, it suits where his voice is at. It's quite pleasant. I like the ending too. It's kind of it's a strange ending. It's more of a coda really, where it kind of picks up. It almost reminds me of Ladies from War Child. He does sing on the end, but yeah, Cornucopia, I think, is a great bit of the album. Nice little bit of breathing space. Nice contrast with the rest of the stuff because it is, you know, quite gentle and pleasant. And yeah, one of my favorites on the album. Move on to track 10. Another one of my favorites, The Navigators. I think this is pretty typical of the rest of the stuff. Maybe it's a cousin of Wolf Unchained, but another high energy track. I really like, there's a keyboard part that comes up in here. It's got that, it's a patch. It's got this really, there's a lot of low end on it. Boom, don't, 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 boom, boom, boom. I think that sounds really, really, really good. And it kind of harkens back to that mid-80s era. Again, you know, Broadsword and the Beast or Under Wraps kind of era. And I don't think there's enough of that on this album. Like there are some kind of nice keyboard flourishes that pop up here and there, but I would enjoy it more if there was a little bit more of that available. But on the whole, it's like I said, as a song, I think it works really well. It's a little bit more elaborate. There's some cool middle sections to it. I really like there's an ascending bit. Da dun 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 da dun dun da dun dun da da da. That part is really, really good. Yeah, I would be a contender for one of my favorites on the album. He played this one live as well. But yeah, Navigators, very good song. Classic bit of modern era Tull slash Ian Anderson. Move on to track 11, Guardian's Watch. Now we're kind of getting into the reprises. This kind of helps make it feel like more of a, you know, a whole as a concept album. For the most part, this is just a reprise of The Perfect One, and as such, I find it very different, difficult to recall it. I'm not sure. It seems so strange. The song that he chose to use as a reprise moment is the one that I find hardest to get stuck in my head. I hear it twice every time I hear the album, but I can't think of it right now. I listened to it just this morning, actually. But it's you know, it suits the context of the album. Again, as you get to the end, it's nice to have those little reprises. It reminds us that we are listening to a total listening experience. It's not just, you know, picking out songs here and there. And yeah, I guess I don't have that much to say about it really, other than it's you know, it makes it more proggy, more of a concept album. And that leads us to the final track on the album, track 12, Eithovál. I'm sorry. There's at least two on here that I feel very not confident in pronouncing, and Eithovál, the final track on the album, is one of them. This, of course, is a reprise of a lot of the themes from Völuspá, the opening track. We get that we get the spoken word, the female spoken words, speaking the Norse language. A few riffs from the first track are reintroduced. Brief little bit of Ian singing, and of course, it all winds its way back up with that. That menacing flute from the very beginning of the album. And yeah, it wraps things up decently well enough. So yeah, I mean, on the whole, it's not a bad album. There's a lot to like. I did feel a little bit disappointed. It does, you know, Of the four, relatively recent albums since 2012, so Tab 2, Homo Erraticus, Zealot Gene, and this one, this is probably comes closer to the bottom of the pack. I'm sure, I'll listen to it more. I've listened to it to at least, I've listened to it at least 15, 20 times since it's come out. It's been out for almost a year. It's one of those ones that I really want to like and I really want to enjoy and I want to get into it, and I do. But my immediate feeling afterwards is, well, maybe I'll listen to Homo Erraticus or, I like the Zealot Gene. It doesn't quite have enough, it's not quite as diverse enough for me. I like that the Zealot Gene has those acoustic bits and it's a little bit more up and down, it's a little more diverse. This seems a bit more flat, but that's okay. He can do, whatever he wants. He's earned the right to do it. And I hope I don't sound, overly critical of Anderson in this particular review, but I mean, I will say, I mean, in his later career, let's just be totally open. He does seem to make odd decisions the older he gets. Obviously, like the biggest factor is his voice, is the limitations on his voice nowadays. But he doesn't seem to tailor his sets to suit his voice, and I think, for me, like my thinking, I would assume that a lot of the fans that are going to see Jethro Tull shows are pretty hardcore fans in this day and age, or people that are gonna, I would think they would be able to pick out tracks from the later years, from, recent albums, or even like late 80s, like Crest of a Knave, Rock Island, Roots to Branches, JToll.com. Like, I feel like he's not taking advantage of that repertoire nearly enough, because those songs are much more suited for his voice, and he's always going for the quote Tull classics. Now, obviously, Ian's got a better idea of the demographics that come to his shows than I would, and if that's what he feels people want to hear, then obviously those are the tracks that he's going to play. But I feel it doesn't always suit his voice, and there's some clips on YouTube where, oh, he shouldn't be like a track like Songs from the Wood in this day and age. I don't think he should be doing that anymore unless he has another singer. There's no shame in that. There's no shame having a different singer. I forget the guy's name. It's gonna bug me. Give me 2 seconds here. I'll find it because he sang on Homo Erraticus, which is right here. He had that other singer. I saw Ian live in 2013 when he was doing Thick as a Brick 1 and 2. Books are so valuable. There's so many little details here. If I could only find the band. Ryan O'Donnell. That's the guy's name. So he was doing kind of like, back, a secondary lead vocalist for the Thick as a Brick 1 and 2 tour. And I thought he was great. He definitely was able to evoke the spirit of 70s Ian Anderson. And I, when that show was presented, and he had Ryan O'Donnell there doing a lot of the vocals, I thought, oh, this is great. He's gonna have, a young guy is gonna be able to do all the songs. He can just open up the repertoire. It's all gonna sound great. The band can really let loose instead of, I feel that the modern bands do kind of hold back a little bit, again, just to suit Ian's limitations, whether it's vocally, musically, what, who knows? I mean, he's getting up there, let's be real. But I thought with this other singer, it was a great opportunity because he could hit this other singer could handle the hard parts. Ian can sing here and there wherever it's, suitable, or he's within his range. And then Ryan O'Donnell disappeared, and he just kind of kept going on. And I will say his voice has improved a little bit in some of the videos I've seen, like in the early 2020s. Compared to there's a huge range, where his voice kind of sits these days. But yeah, it just seems strange. I mean, the set list choices are a little odd, and again, even in his later years, back in the 70s, his big thing was he was essentially a folk guy who had this big loud rock band in behind him, and he always wanted to play like the folkier stuff, whereas he's at a stage in his career now, he can do whatever he wants, and he's choosing to play the hard, heavy rock stuff. I think I said before earlier, what I would love to see from Ian is more stuff kind of like, Rupee's Dance or Secret Language of Birds. I think that would suit his voice, and I think that's, more reflective of him as an artist, in my opinion. Obviously he's the artist, and most recently this is the kind of stuff that he wanted to do, and I can't fault him for that. I can't fault him for putting the sets together. I've got a lot of respect for him one way or another. He's out there and he's doing his best, but for me personally, I would like to see him, playing songs live that suit his current voice and or have another singer up there. There's no shame in that. You can still host the show, and you can have someone else, you know, and then you can play stuff from Minstrel in the Gallery and War Child, and all, you know, you can do Songs from the Wood, and it'll sound really good again. But and you know, I hope if we do get another Jethro Tull or Ian Anderson solo record, I'm hoping it's going to be acoustic, because that's you know, that seems to be Ian's heart and soul. But what do I know? I'm not Ian. I'm just some guy from Canada. And again, talking about live, I just might as well destroy this in this video while it's still recording. I think I mentioned in my other video, I was lucky enough to see Martin Barr with his band. It was just the Martin Barr band. About 2 years ago, and it was an absolutely phenomenal show. I would encourage, you know, any you know, fans of Jethro, you know, the legacy of Jethro Tull, I would absolutely recommend check out Martin Barr, the Martin Barr Band. It is really, really good. They play all the classics, but they play a lot of deep cuts as well. He was playing some stuff from Under Wraps, a lot of stuff from War Child, like Sea Lion was a track that he played. And but the thing is that the band is high energy. He's got a great singer. His name is Dan Crisp. There's no flute or anything like that, but like they play the songs closer to the way that would have been played in the 70s, which was, you know, loud, aggressive, in your face, and, you know, high energy. Whereas a Tull show, it feels more like a theater production now. Everyone comes out and they play their instruments, and it is correct and it is good, and that's fine. But it's very polite. Tull is, you know, modern Tull is very polite, whereas I think the Martin Barr band comes closer to, you know, the recklessness of the early days. So that's just a little aside. If Martin Barr comes to your town, highly recommend it, because it is a great display of all the great stuff that's laid down by the legacy of Jethro Tull. It's a shame Ian's no longer with Ian these days, but again, maybe it's not, because otherwise we wouldn't have, you know, an official, you know, someone who's been in the Tull, you know, pantheon for, you know, 99% of their existence, out there representing some of that other material. So maybe that's the silver lining of Martin not being in Jethro Tull anymore, is that we do have, you know, sort of an official band out there playing the Tull repertoire, and they're doing a damn fine job of it. Anyway, I've been ranting and raving too long. We were talking about The Zealot Gene by Jethro Tull. The most recent album, you know, who knows? I'm sure there'll be another one out, you know, before long. Hopefully it'll be acoustic, like I said. And yeah, this completes, or at least updates, my Jethro Tull ranting and rambling videos. So thank you very much. I hope you're doing well, and yeah, stay tuned. You'll see me in the future. Take care. Bye-bye.